We're live. We're back. I'm back. Where's it all going now? Right, okay. Yeah. No, is this the one? No. Oh. It's still done. I done it. Yay! Hello. And welcome to Fishing Friday. Let's rewind this. Fuck me. This is outrageous, this one, isn't it? It just went off. Damn it. I don't know whether it's been a glitch in the broadband, but it just went, you know, no signal. And I'm going like, it'll come back on. Fuck. David Poulsen, someone was getting a bit cocky with the tech. I wasn't getting cocky with the tech. I never get cocky with tech. No. Well, sometimes. But, right. I set it all up. I did the whole thing, and then it was the portrait stuff that we went through on the first third of the episode. What's it now? It's 25 past, 3 breakdowns already. This is going to be a record. Kenny T, thank you very much, mate. Alex English, hello again. Tech is not my friend. It's like, I'm serious. It's just, I'm cursed. I'm really, really cursed with this shit, right? And it was, but yeah, so I did the broadband just went down, and I just lost everything in the house. And I tried to go up on the thing, but it was just down. So, John O'Malley, gremlins. Gremlins, O'Malley. Roddy McLeod, the show always goes on, right? So where was I? Where am I going to get... This is like one of them gigs, you know, when it all goes down and like suddenly you've got a keyboard player going... And you just go, oh, shit. Right. And I remember one time in Philadelphia with Mickey Simmons. And it was on that tour with the Sunsets album. And the crew hated him, right? Because everybody else had kind of got rigs that were kind of nicely sorted out. Mickey's rig looked like... It was a spaghetti factory behind it. It was just everything was plugged in and wired in, and it was loads of cables, and it was a nightmare. It took longer than the drums to set up, right? And it went down in Philadelphia, right in the middle of the set, and it was like, you know, and the crew are just going, the local crew are going, and I'm just going, oh bollocks. And I did about 30 minutes of stand-up, right? I did about 30 minutes of stand-up covering for Mickey in Philadelphia. But that's part of the frontman's gig, isn't it? It's like, you know, so like any juvenile frontman out there looking for tips, it's like, be prepared for shit to happen, right? And that's one of the reasons why I've always been kind of really reluctant, you know, to get involved with backing tracks and stuff. I mean, there are a lot of bands, and I've seen a lot of bands with backing tracks. I mean, basically, they take the studio tapes out, and they take the whole thing out, and most of the stuff that's coming out of that PA is actually kind of what was on the album. We do use samples, and we do use bits for the album. I have it, but I don't basically play along to, you know, a 7-minute sequence or whatever, you know. And Steve Vances knows this, and he knows exactly what I'm like, because A, I'm a singer, So, like, I'm very unsure of where I'm coming in anyway. And, you know, and the lyrics are so complicated. If you screw up or whatever, you got to be, you know, especially if you're lining up the guys or whatever in the pieces, or if a certain section is defined by a lyric, then, you know, I don't like sitting along a big long line of kind of stuff that I've got to drop my bit into. And I like to have it cut into little chunks, like a little child with mince, you know. I like to have the songs kind of broken down into parts so that if we want to take a part a little bit longer, we can do that. And it's, and Gavin controls that from the rolling kit. But I mean, backing tapes as full backing tapes, and, you know, where you're relying on most of the music coming from the backing tapes. I mean, everybody plays on the stage in my band. Everybody plays, you know, everything on the stage. But it's just those little, it's the, you know, a bit of 12-inch acoustic guitar or whatever, or, you know, maybe there's an extra rhythm track or something that's going on. But it's, Andrew Evans, all frontman, need a witty repertoire to add a little bit any moment. You do, you know, and I've been caught. I've been really caught out a couple of times, you know, when something major has gone down. I think my it wasn't really an ad lib. It was more a take charge of the situation, and I remember we played. I was with the SES band, and we played Bansko. It was Bansko in Bulgaria, and it was an amazing place. It was away up the. It was away up in the mountains. It was a skiing place, and basically, during the summer, they come up with this great idea to put a kind of mini festival on in the kind of in this park area, and the park was kind of about halfway down the hill, right? And the hotel, our hotel, was at the top of the hill, right? And I remember going in there, and we arrived late-ish. In fact, it was Yatta and I arrived late-ish the night before and got whammied, right? And the next, we were supposed to be there for kind of 2 days, I think it was. And the second day, it was all the setup and things. And I remember they had bikes in the hotel, right? So I used to jump on a bike and just go downhill. It was brilliant. It was like having a car. It was like a carry, or bogey. Right? And I used to go down the bike all the way down to the stage area. And then I'd get a lift back with one of the crew guys that was going back up. So, like, I'd go down to see what was happening down in the staging area, right? And then hang about for a bit, maybe have a beer and go back up. And we were, it was a whole day setup, I think it was. And then, can't remember exactly what it was because I was very, very drunk at the time. And being on a bike and going down through this Bulgarian mountain village, it's like you'd be going down, you turn a corner, there'd be cobbles and goats jumping out of the way and chickens, just like one of them movies you get, you know, like carts just missing you and donkeys going, wow. It was really cool, but it was great. And it took you about maybe 10 minutes to get down the hill, right? 10 minutes to get all to go down all through these windy streets and stuff. It was fantastic. Down at the festival site that was continually being built. And I noticed with my professional eye that the staging wasn't exactly what I expected and perhaps sufficient enough for a festival thing. And especially, it was like the security fence, right, in front of the stage was basically a bit of tape, right? But the most creepy thing about it, right, was that they had all these mixing desks, right? And they were all sitting underneath these gazebos that you can buy out of B&Q. You know, they're for, like, you know, the sort of thing you buy in a summer, right, and you use it once and never use it again, right? They were flimsy, right? And they were all stacked over these big, expensive mixing desks and amplifiers and you know, all the out front gear was sitting under these kind of B&Q gazebos. And it was like, we came to do the gig, that was it. We came to do the gig that night, and the forecast was going to be rain, right? And it started, and it pelted down and pelted down and pelted down. And we were doing this gig with Bonnie Tyler. So Bonnie Tyler was kind of... she was on before us, and then this sass band went on where Chris Thompson's and Paul Young's and blah, 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 right? But Bonnie Tyler was kind of, she was really, I was supposed, the headline act, and we were kind of like the party band that played after, you know, the SES jukebox bit. And and it was raining so hard, it was unbelievable. And there was about maybe 2,000, 2,500 people on the other side of the tape, the security tape. And Bonnie was up on the stage, and the rain was falling on the stage. It was getting dangerous, right? And the next thing, everything just went pop. And the rain had come in through, in between all the cracks, in between the B&Q and gazebos, and gone into the mixing desks, right? And just popped the entire out front. And then the only lights that were left were like the little kind of like guard lights, security lights, going about, and like, I'm going, what? And Bonnie immediately came off the stage. And at the backstage area was basically, it was a circle of caravans, like a kind of Wild West scenario. And Bonnie and all the guys, and everybody's got a bit steaming as well, because there's a lot of cheap alcohol around. And Bonnie's tour manager's going like, we're going, that's it, we've got to get the hell out of here, there's going to be a riot. And everybody's getting really panicky, right? And there's 2,500 people out there that didn't know what was happening, right? And nobody was willing to go up, right, and tell them that the gig's off, because obviously, because of the mixing desk blown up, right, there was no way they could repair them that night, right? And they were going to have to bring new mixing desks in from Sofia. So I just basically went up to the promoter and said, look, I said, can you get new mixing desks? Why don't we just do the gig tomorrow, right? I said, tell him I'll come back tomorrow. And he's going, got to talk to the committee. So you'll do this and you won't charge any more. No. And I spoke to Spike and stuff like that. Bonnie Tyler was having nothing. Right, none of it. They were off somewhere else, right? But we were down there for another day in the mountains, right? With the bikes and the hill and the baby. So I talked Spike, and everybody else was really up for it. So I said, yeah, let's do the gig tomorrow. And they go, well, who's going to announce it? I said, I'll do it. Just give me an interpreter. Right? And I said, if you can give me, you know, a couple of speakers at the PA running off a small amp. I said, you know, I'll do it. And up I went, onto the rain-soaked stage, with a glass in my hand. And it was like, hello, guys, how you doing? Really sorry, but we've had a major problem, da-da-da. And they were a bit, first, and da-da-da. After about 5-10 minutes of me and the translator, everybody's happy. Free gig tomorrow. Everybody welcome. And that was it. And then we went back to the pub and got absolutely smashed. It was, but yeah, that was my front man taking charge of a situation like in band school. I got to go down. Christian Drusen, wetter than an otter's pocket. Laurie Fairweather, thought I'd push myself by the end of the day, right? I had to do a bass solo once, Kerry Tate, because the PA went down and I was on my own amp, so I was the only one who could do anything. This one's written by Jazz Odyssey, written by the bass player. Robin Elliott, it's not as wet as Run Rig at Loch Ness in 2007. I wasn't there, mate. Bonnie, a good Swansea girl. Aunt James, yeah, she's good. She's nice lass, great song, great singer, and great thrapple, as they say up here. Right. Carol Parker helped build a stage for the Beach Boys once in a tornado, small dust devil. Came through the sound check and picked up chairs everywhere. We hunkered down front of the house and waited till it calmed down. I remember in Marillion, and about, it could have been the real tour or something. We were playing. It was in northern Italy. I think it was Turin. And we were playing in a car park. We always played, we played a lot of car parks in Italy, right? You know, they just set up a stage and they put security kind of, proper, not tape, right? But like proper fencing around it, and they seal off the area. And there were small festivals and they were great. You know, some days you'd be like, you know, sitting, you'd be on the stage with sun coming full in your face and go like, ah. And other days, like in Turin, it rained and rained and rained. Turin is a big rain thing for me. I'm a big rain town, right? Rain town. And, they set the stage up in a small depression. And it was a car park. It was like a bowl, right? And we came up, and the entire front of the stage was basically in about 6 inches of water. And they're going, oh, go ahead. Well, no problem. They stand in the water. That's it. You can maybe ask the punters to stand in the water, but we're not going to be standing with electric instruments in a puddle of water. The show was cancelled. Sue Wright, SES band, yo. Andrew Stewart, Soapy Aid and St. Helens. We did that one a couple of weeks back. Oh, by the way, all the Fishing Fridays, every single one of them is going to be on YouTube and also on Facebook and stuff like that. So everything's going to be up. Greg Firth, good evening. Lee Brown, just wondering if you like the Edinburgh Fringe. I know some of the locals in Edinburgh aren't that fussed. I like the Fringe, and it can be really addictive. I think you've got to be mentally and physically prepared, right, to do the Edinburgh Fringe, you know, which is the pre-festival stuff. I mean, it's a bit like doing the West Island Way without walking for at least 10, 15 mile a week. I found it really exhausting, and there's like too much. It's kind of like a Chinese buffet sometimes, you know, and you know, it's the planning out the days, and you know, at 10 o'clock we've got to be at this theatre, then you know, we're going here, and then we're going for lunch, and then we're going to try and then we're going there, then we've got tickets for this, and then we've got 2 hours in the pub to wait till the next show. And I get OD'd on it. And I've enjoyed, I mean, Simone and I have been in a couple of times, and you know, we've gone in to specifically see shows that have been highly recommended or that we just really fancy seeing. Simone loves the King's Theatre. She went one of the times when I was away. She went into the King's Theatre with a couple of friends and she absolutely loved it. And she's on at me to go back to the King's, which I really want to do because I've not been there. I remember seeing Hamlet there when I was at Dalkeith High School. They took us all in because we had to see Hamlet because it was in the curriculum. And I remember seeing Lenny the Lion, we were talked about before a previous Fishing Friday. And that was Terry Dubry. And I had his autograph. I got Lenny the Lion's autograph. Lenny. I really believe the lion could write. somebody can come up and tell me with that one. A lot of the word thrapple is a throat, right? But yeah, Lenny the Lion. Who is Lenny? Who is the hand behind Lenny the Lion? And I saw Jamie. The one thing I do remember going in when I was really young, my mum and dad took me in, and I think it must have been a pantomime. And it was called Jamie. And it was the story of a young Scots boy, and he wore a kilt. It was all that kind of. There was a touch of Brigadoon and a touch of Kidnapped It, and it was a great wee story for me when I was a kid. I loved it, and I loved that whole thing about, you know, Jamie and the theatre. But I have no idea what it was, but I think it was just called Jamie. But I'm sure somebody on the computer will come up and like tell me more, right? But yeah, Terry Hall. Was it Terry Hall? Was he the singer in that Birmingham band? Yeah. Terry Hall. But Lenny the Lion. This kind of like, this Chinese lion look about him and stuff, right? I watched, yeah, I got taken. Because the reason I should have said, the reason I got his autograph is because I went backstage to meet a glove puppet. Want to meet Lenny.
There you are, son. Thank you very much, Derek. There's your signature.
And I had it for years. I did. It was probably worth a fortune on eBay now. Lenny the Lion, oh, millions. Oh, that's another story, but I should have got that off. But I'll maybe tell you about that next week. 28/7. Phil Wood, yeah, the Fishing Fridays on YouTube, yeah. James Patton including this one, all three parts of it. Okay, right? Hi, Liam. Mark Sanders. Better to go the week before the Fringe when less people, but the full show is still as pre-Fringe. The Fringe just keeps on melding backwards. I think, you know, the problem with Edinburgh during the festival is you can get shell-shocked by the sound of suitcases rolling along pavements and cobbled streets. It's like, it's this kind of, I don't know, it's like Glastonbury. I mean, I personally would never go to Glastonbury. I mean, I mean, to go down with that many people, Simona's exactly the same. It's like, just, you know, the only festival that I would go to, right, as a kind of punter, but then again, I wouldn't really be a punter, right, would be Croppredy. And that is one of my favourite ever festivals that I've ever kind of been at and done. A lot of fun. And it's, but you know, to go to Glastonbury, I mean, oh, it's just, it's too big, you know, for, it's too old for this shit, right? But yeah, I mean, you know, with festivals, I mean, standing up for ages, I mean, that's the thing with Croppredy, you know, you take along your deck chair, you know? And the Croppredy, I definitely want to, you know, I would consider, even if I was retired, going down and doing a couple of songs at Croppredy, you know, with a band, with the Fairports, we all love. Because Peggy is one of the funniest guys. And Simona and I spent a night with Peggy and his wife and a couple of the other guys. And it was just, it was brilliant. Because Peggy's wife's actually, she's German. And I said, do you remember Marillion concert in Zenith Paris, 85? Yeah, Zenith was... I loved the Zenith shows, and I loved the backstage at the Zenith shows, because it's like, I remember we actually played at the Zenith at a time when, oh, what's his name, the big French rock and roller, oh no, well, oh, Johnny Hallyday was doing a whole, he was doing like, you know, 40 shows, 50 shows in a row or something. He had like a lifetime residency. I think most of it allegedly had to do with paying off his tax bill with the French government, right? But he played the Zenith, and I think all the proceeds for the Zenith actually went to the tax man. But I remember being backstage at the Zenith, and Johnny Hallyday had this thing where... And I know this because the lighting techs that were doing the Johnny Hallyday show were the same firm called LSD, Light and Sound Design from Birmingham. They were the same guys. And we kind of met up with them the night before and things, you know. And I remember it was like, you know, there was this massive hand, right? I mean, a hand made out of paper mache or something, right? Or plaster of Paris, right? There was a massive hand, a giant's hand, into which, and it was gloved. Right, and it was gloved, so like, you know, it kind of, and basically this big gloved hand came out of the backstage area at the start of the show and went like that, right? I thought, I'll go like that, right? And Johnny Hallyday stood in the middle, right? And that was it. It was a one-trick pony. And they spent a fortune on this thing, this one thing, this one, the big hand that comes out. Get straight into your hair, Johnny Hallyday. Do-do-do-do-do-do. But yeah, so, the Zenith, I remember the Zenith. I loved, it was a really weird gig because the crowd, when it was empty, it was rubbish. It was really echoey and horrible, but when everybody came in, it was beautiful. But my favourite gig in Paris, and the one I would love to do, you know, kind of on a farewell tour, I would love to play the Olympia. Like, I loved the Olympia as a venue. It was always my favourite, and I always wanted to go back there, you know. I definitely preferred it over the Zenith, right? Oh, M8 went to Edinburgh when the Tattoo was supposed to be on last year. It was an amazing experience, the city with a lack of tourists in the summer. Yeah, I mean, it's a shame about the festival. I mean, you know, the city thrives, you know, and the festival's going to be different after COVID. And I think, you know, as well, I think leaving the EU is going to affect it in some way as well. I mean, for the very fact, I mean, I hate to go back over this, but for the very fact, a lot of the actors and a lot of artists and a lot of performers will be requiring visas to come across and play the Edinburgh Festival. And you don't play the Edinburgh Festival to make money. If, you know, you go there for the recognition. Like, the comedians go there to be recognised, unless you're a name and you're playing the big venues, you know? I mean, people do not make money at the Edinburgh Festival. The rents and the rooms for musicians and stuff are, like, it's outrageous because they're competing with tourists. And so, I mean, it's sad. But, I mean, we just have to see where things go, you know? Greg Hale at Hoodies Glastonbury when you have Midfest at Dalkeith County Park. Absolutely. I love playing that. Dude, Misplaced Shell, dude. At Dalkeith County Park. That was a gig. That was a gig and a half. Anders Sundelin, hello from Sweden. Johnny Halliday is Belgian, I think. Jay Hendrix, no, I think he's French. Right? I don't know. Clark McSevy, was that when Jim Prime was playing with Johnny? I don't think so. I didn't know Jim Prime, who was the Deacon Blue keyboard player at that. I didn't really know Deacon Blue right about then, but it's, I don't know. I would think Jim Prime would have been Deacon Blue if it was 85, because the DBs were running big at that time. Chris Harris, you remember LSD, great light shows. LSD, I used to love LSD. I mean, light and sound design. Who do you use for lights? LSD. We give it to everybody. They'll love the light show. Right. It was light and sound design. And Yatta used to work for light and sound. Chops McFleury, Robert Fleury, who was the Marillion, the lighting guy. All the guys, Fats and everybody, all came through there. There was loads of people. Right. And they became great friends. And that was... Weary loads, you just be booming, look it out. Yeah, so running about to all these crews, lodging crew, all talking like that, you know. Was he known, Chris Wright, was he known for his heartfelt glove songs? Doug Musgrove, would you play any bikers' gigs, the farmyard? It's. Bikers' gigs. I remember playing in Maidenhead once. With Marillion, and it must have been 1981. And I think it might have been Keith Goodwin, our press guy, that told me about this gig. And we played it, and I think it was a Sunday afternoon, right? It wasn't a nighttime gig, right? And we set up on this stage, right? It wasn't a stage. Stage was that high. It was like that. It was basically like a step. We played under this big... it wasn't even a big step. And in front of it was this kind of round wooden kind of dance floor. And round about that on the arc were all the tables and the chairs. And so we were playing this gig in Maidenhead that I'd booked. I think we were getting 60 quid for it or something like that. Maybe 60, right? And of course it was like where we playing Fish. Oh God, it's a good gig. It wasn't the Bell. I don't think it was the Bell in Maidenhead, but it was some gig in Maidenhead, this pub, and we went on stage right with the makeup and everything. Right, well, I'm with the makeup, right, and our audience was the Windsor chapter of the Hells Angels. The only other daunting gig that I played like that was when I played the SAS Barracks in Hungerford, but that's another story, right? But going out, this gig on a Sunday afternoon, and you're faced with the Windsor chapter of the Hells Angels. I went squeaky. And I thought, well, we got to do a show. And we just went on and we did the show. We did a full Marillion show, and I did Grendel, and it was like, dun, dun, dun. And there was nobody played about with me or anything like that. They let us do the show, and they were very respectful. And they loved it. And it was like, we just kind of shook hands and thanks, but I was a bit like, oh, nice to meet you. You know, just, oh. And they all scooted off and roared off in the late afternoon and stuff. And it was like, whoa. And the next time I met them was at Reading. And I was in the beer tent. I can't remember when it was, but it was... And Lemmy was there, and Lemmy was talking. Lemmy was in the corner for these Hells Angels guys, and I walked up and went, "Oh, how you doing?" And they went, "Oh, Fish, Marillion, blah blah blah." And it was like Lemmy's in the corner going, "Like fucking hell!" I think he was just a wee bit off. He was having an off day that day, and he was a bit freaked out. But yeah, and the only other time I had there was a Hells Angel kind of story was when we played at Boss Pop, and I think it was 1993. And and we were doing the covers. It's when I was doing the Boston Tea Party stuff and things. And I'm standing on the stage and I'm kind of singing away. I think it was just, I think I just finished a number. And this guy just walks on from the side of the stage, right? And he's got this great big orange T-shirt on, right? And he's holding an orange T-shirt that he wants to give to me, right? And all the security guys at the side of the stage, I'm going, who is this guy? He's a promoter or something, right? And I'm going, he's walking on, we're kind of like, nobody's stopping him. So like, is, you know, is he coming to change the mic? You know, no. And the guy comes up and gives me a T-shirt, gives me a big hug, and walks off. And I said, who was that guy? Right. And I said, oh, that was the head of Hell's Angels Holland. I'm going, fuck that. Yeah, security said, we're not going to stop him. And Hell's Angels were seemingly involved with the thing. Right. But it was, yeah, that was the, that was a strange, who's that guy? Who the hell was that? Right. Well, that's, ah, Paul Boggy, hello. Max Verstappen is Dutch. Right. Rico Anker sleeping in a tent at the farmhouse next to the goats and cows. So were you watching the programme? Uh-huh. Oh, Johnny Halliday had a Belgian father born in Paris, Thomas Kidd. There you go. See, you learn stuff all the day. Michael Forshaw, Big Hills Angels Bar in Maidenhead. Yeah, but I can't remember the name of the pub. You know, but we got a gig there, right? The only other gig I got. They used to love me, right? I got a gig in the Caribbean Club in Oxford, right? And that was about 120 quid, right? That was like, in the money, boys. And I just find places on the back of the sounds, right? And phone them up. Right? That's what I did, and send them a demo tape. There must be hundreds of demo tapes, the original kind of, this one. This one here. That one. That's the original Marillion demo tape, Lesbian. And I got that, my mum gave me that when she was emptying her house, right? And that's the flying saucer that was put on, but this minute, wonder why there was a flying saucer there. But yeah, and I used to basically get in touch with all these people and go through the sounds, all the music magazines, and you'd have the name of the gig name, and then a lot, more often than not, you'd have a phone number, or you'd go through the ads, so you'd have like the Limelight Club or whatever, you get the number of the Limelight, phone them up, blag your way through to whoever's booking the gigs, blah, 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 talk them up, going, yeah, we do this, and blah, 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 and we've done this, and we support this, and we support John Martin, support Spirit, you know, really up and happening band, do you want to say, we've got a demo tape, right? And that's what I did. And I don't know what happened, but I think the guy at the Caribbean Club didn't listen to the demo tape. He just booked a band because he just heard Marillion and maybe thought it was some Caribbean Calypso band, because we turned up at this venue again. We were supposed to play two sets. That was it. We were supposed to play a lunchtime set and then an evening set. So we turned up for the lunchtime set. Welcome in, blah, blah, blah. Mellotron up on the stage. Ooh. And it's just, and it was just all Caribbean guys, right? There was one French girl, there was one white French girl, and all the rest were black guys, right? All Caribbean, and it was like, you know, you're just going like, you know, okay, that's cool, you know, fair enough, it's a gig, you know. The Caribbean, not thinking for one minute how progressive rock could possibly go down in a reggae bar, in a Caribbean bar in Oxford on a Sunday afternoon. And everything, and there was, the bar, which was mostly Red Stripe, I think that's what we got. We got a bunch of Red Stripe, you know, and it was, that's cool. I don't love Red Stripe. Huh? Food was brilliant. It was all kind of, it was all Caribbean food. It was a really zippy hot, right? And then we went on to play the set, and the stage was quite tidy. It was kind of like in a bay window sort of vibe, I seem to remember. And it was, you know, a couple of feet high. You know, it was enough to get everything on, including the Mellotron and Pointer's drum kit and shit. And we played to about four guys standing at the bar, right? Just looking at us going like, who the fuck are you? What the fuck is this shit? Are we playing Grendel? I think they asked us to take a break in the set. Right? Well, they asked us to play for like half an hour and then take a break or something, right? And the only person that was really getting off us was this French girl who was completely off her face. And she's just dancing like that, doing that Stacia dance in the floor, right? And the guys are just looking at her going, yeah. And she's dancing like crazy. And we're going like, well, we've probably, you know, we've found a fan. And we played about half a minute, and the guy came up to the stage, and he just gave us all the money in cash. He said, look, man, he said, you know, he says, I think we better just call it a day. This ain't going to work here. Here's the money. We're going, oh, thanks very much. It's like, you know, it's really nice. You know. And, you know, I wasn't going to do the thing. You're like, is there any chance of coming back to do another one? It was the most polite way I've ever been told to fuck off in my life. And don't come back. John Urie, Angel Guys Must Have Loved 52. It's, well, I know Dog's Mates and Dog's Bite guys in America did. Greg Hale, I think the concert you're talking about was Altamont, the Rolling Stones gig. Norbert Letterburn, do you remember your concert in East Berlin in 1988? Yeah, I remember that. I had issues that day, but that was my thing. It was more than anything else. Alan Mitchell, do you remember the Town Hall in Elgin? Yeah. Yeah, we used to play Keith. I'll deal with that another time. I'll go into that side, because if I go into Keith, then it goes into my forestry world as well up there. And it's Peter I want to talk to before that happens. Right. Luis Pudenle Rivas from Lima, Peru. Hello. Mari Esteban, Caribbean Calypso Band. You could see it on Marillion. Marillion. Doom. Marillion. Carol Lois Olsen, a tape line around 8 minutes of fish interview. My highlight is a journalist, the only one. Richard Llewellyn, Marillion were never a dub band. Stuart Evans was the chicken wire there. Yeah, it did feel like the Blues Brothers. It did. I mean, you stand there, you could just feel the antagonism in the room. You could just feel it, sense it. You know, it's like that classic TV thing where you get the guy behind the bar because cleaning the glass forever, looking at you, going like, yeah, like Steve Welsh, Blues Brothers getting booked for a redneck bar. I've done other ones. We've been in places, like I said, I used to, the Marillion shows, it was like, if I could get a gig, if I could find a venue and we were paid for it, then we'd play it anywhere. Linda Dublin, got any help? Did Marillion do an arena documentary during the Clutching at Straws tour? It was about behind the scenes of a rock tour, truck drivers, crew, etc. Yes, we did. And it was filmed in Lausanne, and I think it finished in Paris, funnily enough. And it could have been when we were doing... I'm sure it was the Clutching tour. And... Yeah, they interviewed all the crew. It was for a kids thing. I seem to think. I don't think it was like a proper documentary. It was part of a children's program. Steve Blacknell was involved in it. He was an old friend of mine. Yeah, Steve Blacknell. He was the one that did the interviews. Laurie Fairweather, there is something on YouTube. There is. I think if you Google Marillion crew film or something, but I'm sure it's Lausanne. It was Lausanne. Anyway, it's 7 o'clock. I'm late. Need to do things. Right. Right, Black Canal. That was the one that was picked out. I love Black Canal. It was jammed in here. It was like the guys kind of put the music down, and I basically came in after everything and basically sculpted it. And added all the different bits and pieces and just jammed my entire part of Black Canal across, you know, what James and the rest of the guys had put together. And it came from when I was in Bruges. And I've always had a thing with Belgium, actually, believe it or not. I mean, it's a family thing. My mum and dad went there just after they got married. And they had friends across there who lived in a place called Capellen. And they were outside Antwerp. And Veerl Peeters, so Veerl, if you're watching, hello. Bonsoir. But yeah, there was Roger and his wife, and Veerl was the daughter. And they were family friends, but it was all to do... They came across to see us. I can't remember who it was. It was some kind of tenuous kind of link with it. But I went out there for the first time in, I think it was, I was just started second school at Dalkeith High. So it must have been, what's that, 1970, it was 71, I think, we were out there. And it was the first time I ever went to Europe with my family, and my dad drove the car across there. It was my dad, my mum, my sister Laura, and myself. And we went across and we went to visit the Belgian family. And my dad and Roger and his wife and stuff had become big friends, my mum and dad and stuff. So we kind of went along, and then we met all these other people that they knew that I didn't know. And they were all people that my mum and dad had met when they first went across to Belgium. And I always remember they had these black and white photographs, which we've still got in a photo book somewhere. And it was this miniature town, and I'd never seen a miniature town before. And it was all these little buildings, and you know, blah blah blah, and an incredible huge model town. And I remember as a kid going like, "Wow, so that's wow, look at the models." But anyway, we went across there. And my mum and dad's friends had a flower shop. And it was the first time I kind of was in this kind of two-story Belgian kind of town, village vibe. And I was wandering about. And it was, I remember the smell of cigars when I went across there. And everybody was, there was all these shops selling cigar bands. And I'd never seen this before, because everybody in Scotland smoked cigarettes. It was only like, you know, kind of, you know, the hoi polloi that kind of like smoked cigars. I mean, my dad, I think I saw a cigar in his mouth once, that's because I gave it as a Christmas present, it nearly killed him, right? And it was, that was guilt. But it was, but yeah, so I was never around cigars, but suddenly you were in these cafes and everybody was smoking cigars. And in the shops, they had all these collectors, like, you know, I used to see stamps, right? And I used to collect stamps when I was a kid, but I wasn't a stamp collector, you know? I just liked the colours. My girl. That's another story. But anyway, so, and I saw that everybody was collecting these cigar bands, and I thought, oh, that's really cool. Thinking that, you know, cigar bands you'll be able to find all over the place, not realising that it was kind of like pretty, it was a more of a Belgian thing, and unless I was going to Belgium on a regular basis, my cigar kind of band collecting days were going to be pretty numbered. But I bought all these cigar bands and had them in a catalogue thing, and it was like the stamps you bought when you, I don't know if people collect the stamps, but you could go into shops and you could buy a bag of like 200 mixed stamps that were all kind of taken off by children and, you know, using steam things and putting bags and sold to, like, you know, guys, young kids. Oh, what a puss, right? But I didn't save up stamps. But the cigar bands, I got in it for a while. And like I said, I remember black coffee. It was the first time I ever saw filter coffee, where, you know, where you've got the glass cup on the bottom and you've got the plastic thing, and then you pour the water in the top, and then you've got to let the water go down, and then you drink the coffee. I'd never seen that before. I thought that was brilliant. And cigar bands, Belgium. And I found it a weird place. Marillion had a strange relationship with EMI Belgium, because right at the start when Script came out, it was reported to us, right, or allegedly said, right, the managing director of EMI Belgium said, what do we need Marillion for? We've already got Genesis. And I think that kind of, it was, it didn't set us off in the best footing. Right? And, but I mean, later on, you know, we played a lot of great gigs there, you know. Not many, but most of the times we played at the Forest Nationale, which was, that was in the 85s and things. But Belgium I always had this thing with because of my family, and it was, and I've had some great gigs in Belgium, and, you know, again, one of my favourite venues in Belgium was the Ancien Belgique, and I used to love playing that. But my problem was that every time I played the Ancien Belgique, my voice was fucked, right? And I think, you know, and I think that's what killed me in Belgium, is that people just went, it's shit, right? It's like, you know, I've seen him three times, and every time he's, you know, I know other singers that have had exactly the same problem. You know, it's like, you know, where, you know, you play two duff gigs in the same thing, two tours in a row, and it's like, you're going to take a hit. And that's what happened with me with the Ancien Belgique. The Rain Gods tour in particular was, I always remember, you know, being given injections before the gig, and Iron Maiden had come along to see us as well, which is just what you really didn't want. And I was just, it was terrible. And I was like talking with Yannick Gers after the gig and things go like, and you're meeting people and you know you've just sung a really shit gig, and they're going, yeah, it was no bad, that, no bad. And you're just going, stop it. But that was Belgium, right? But we went back there in 1993 for this gig in Bruges. And I'd never, like I said, I'd never been down there in that part. And and it was the smell, and I woke up and on the bus, and it was parked right next to the venue, right? And what wasn't helping was that they had a burst sewage pipe, and it had spilled into the venue, right? And they had raw sewage and got into the backstage area of the venue, and it was absolutely honking, right? And we couldn't go in it. It was so bad. It was usual. So we bought joss sticks, and people just went, we'll just stay on the bus. But even when we were on the bus, you could still smell not only the sewage, but because it was really hot when we were down there, right? And it had been going through a bit of a heat wave. There are all these canals that go through the centre of the city, and they were all, because it was a big trading place. And that was kind of, this all spurred the thoughts. I mean, it was a big medieval trading place, and the architecture was phenomenal. And, you know, it just said this was a rich market city, you know. And the canals were actually black. And I remember looking over the top of the bridges and looking down, and it was like a black mirror, right? And it was, and I got talking to a couple of locals, and they said, yeah, I said, it's like all the old drainage systems, right? They're still pumping effluent into the canals, right? They didn't, because it was all medieval, they hadn't been able to put in all at that time in 93. I mean, I hope for God's sake they've done it, sorted out since. But because they couldn't, they found it difficult to put all the drainage systems in, they were having to deal with ancient sewage systems that just weren't capable of dealing with like a city that had grown and grown and grown. And I kind of liked that image, and I kind of liked that, the idea of that. And at the time I was going through the Suits, kind of getting the Suits album together, and we were, you know, and I'd come out of the EMI thing, gone into the Polydor thing, and the Polydor thing at the end with all the wheelings and dealings and you know, the whole juggling act that was going on towards the end of, until they dropped me, right? You know, when I was there, I was so aware of the business, and the business was kind of really intruding, and that was why I decided to call the album Suits, you know. And it was kind of like, you know, the uniform, and it was and I saw that in the city, and the whole Black Canal lyric, and it was the whole idea of the young guy coming along. I mean, similar to Tucson in a way. And it was the young guy coming along and you know, being seduced by the money, by the smell of the cigar, you know. And And that was kind of where it came from. But it was a bit, you know, it was where I touched on, you know, what are you willing to give up for that? You know, and, you know, the actual Black Canal was a sign itself of, like, you know, this society was not critically balanced. And I think, you know, maybe it was an early kind of vision of kind of where the planet was going with plastics, you know, et cetera, et cetera. I mean, it was the fact that, you know, it was an ancient medieval, hugely successful town that had made all its money, like incredible riches. I mean, it was an incredibly rich town at one point. And yet there it was dealing with its own shit all these years later. And I kind of liked that. And I just got pulled into, you know, the kind of stereotypical image of the big businessman, you know, the black cigar. Black Canal, you know, and it just fell together, and like I said, I just let myself go in this control room, and just, and you know, I had bits of lyrics obviously written down. I had lumps of lyrics, but the thing was fitting them in over what had been written, and that was the trick, and it just worked so well. And again, the spoken word sort of stuff that I really like, and I'm going to have to go through there, and I didn't set it up in all the earlier Beric. So. Let's go through. Kevin Tease, who's the painting behind me? It's me. They're all in here because it's like the missus won't have them in the room. Well, I don't want them in the room either, to be honest. Oh, my legs are sore today. Look how clean this is. Well, that bit's not. That desk. That's the main kind of, that's the working desk. And I've got to make a decision at some point when I do change this control room around, whether I keep that desk or not, because it's been there since it's the studio's inception, and so much has happened and been written and been done on that desk. That's where the keyboards, and it's also Steve Vance's little desk, but he doesn't get it anymore. Because if anybody's going to take over that desk, it is moi, les poissons. Here we are. Look how clean it is. It's great. And I got a load of stuff sorted out. Coming through, darling.
Yeah, going.
Simona will be back with us later.
Yes, I start cooking.
Oh, I'm in a nightmare. I've got to tell you a bit in a minute. It's like...
Oh, dear.
Right. Now I've got to find it. Right. Switch is on. Oh, that smells good. What is it?
Nothing yet. That's Liam's.
Oh, that's Ian's. Liam's.
Liam's chicken nuggets without chicken.
That's what we were listening to the other night. PFM. It was, we were listening to Premiata Veneria Marconi, and we were listening to Il Bancetto. We were listening to Photos of Ghosts. It was absolutely stunning. Okay. You were waiting for that one, weren't you? Change inputs to optical. Press play.
that ran right through the heart of this city. Like an open vein full of black, rotten blood. A mirrored surface, broken only by the bubbles, the gas escaping from the stagnating mess that lay on the bottom, fueled by the chemicals and effluent of the city, which was fed in turn by the barges and the ships that followed the line and created the waves across that surface to the dockside where they unloaded their holds, the swarms of people clambering over them. I sat down in a cafe and I was holding my own and minding my own business. And a voice spoke in my ear as if it recognized that I was questioning the source of the smell.
Yes, I do. How you scrub and bleach and boil. You'll never get rid of the smell. Off the